Hachette Audio presents True and Constant Friends, Love and Inspiration from Our Grandmothers, Mothers, and Friends. Written and read by Kelley Paul, with a foreword read by Rand Paul. Includes a Mac and PC compatible PDF of supplementary material.
Kelley has always been a writer, whether writing marketing literature for the telecommunications industry or for her own creative expression. It has been a constant in her life. During my medical training at Duke, she was our main breadwinner, writing for companies in Research Triangle Park. Even when the subject matter was less than scintillating, she had a gift for making it so. Since I entered politics, Kelley is always the first reviewer I seek for my speeches and articles, and she always makes them better. As our sons and friends will attest, she's a great storyteller. So when she told me that she wanted to write about her relationships with her grandmother, mother, and close-knit group of college friends, I knew it would be great. As you know, real men don't cry, or at least they don't usually admit to it. But as I read Kelley's essays, I laughed, I cried, and I was moved. The running joke in our family is that she is such a great storyteller that we weren't sure if she was writing fiction or nonfiction. But the truth is that she always makes real life much more interesting, sometimes more interesting in the telling than perhaps it was in the living. Kelley is convinced that her storytelling gene comes from the Irish grandmother she speaks about in this audiobook. But I think she got a healthy dose from her father Hilton, too. He can tell a story you've heard 100 times and still reel you in for the climax. My family may count fewer dramatic storytellers in our ranks, but it is not that we don't have a story to tell. In this book, Kelley writes of the powerful sources of inspiration of our mothers and grandmothers, and in the Paul family, that's also certainly true. The women in my family have been long-lived, strong-willed, and opinionated. From my grandmothers to my mother run a strength and direction that has guided our family for generations. Even during times in history when women didn't often take leadership roles in society, the women in my family were quiet yet powerful directors of our destiny. In the winter of 1903, my maternal great-grandmother, Millicent Duncan Creed, wrote over 100 letters to her fiancé, Herman. She described great snowfalls and 22-degree below-zero weather. She described exhilarating sleigh rides and buggy rides, and how much more delightful they would have been with him by her side. Herman worked in a sawmill about 60 miles away. In those days, before automobiles, it was a major undertaking to travel that far, and so he returned only on holidays. The train took her letters to him. Her letters warned him not to have too much fun or pay too much attention to the German girls there. She wrote of Sabbath day, school, sermons, and lectures. Often, she wrote of missing church because of quarantine for smallpox or measles or muddy, impassable roads. I was surprised that Millicent wrote about a new card game that was all the rage and helped alleviate their cabin fever during the harsh winter. When she had visited us down in Texas in her late 80s, we were told that she strongly disapproved of cards and had never played. We took particular delight in corrupting her with a game of old maid. Little did we know that once upon a time in her rebellious youth, she enjoyed a good game of cards. But we didn't stop there. We also took my great-grandmother to her first movie, Chitty Chitty Bang Bang, which she loved. Oh, the rebellious influence of children in the 70s. In addition to Millicent's letters in 1903 and 1904, Herman's mother wrote occasionally to him. She was ill with chronic symptoms of age, but her strong faith gave her comfort. She wrote this to Herman in March of 1904. Our Sabbath was lovely, which I spent at home as usual. But the dear Lord willing, I hope I can go to his house again. Anyway, his grace is sufficient for me. There is a song in my soul today, a blessed sunshine that no outward circumstances can take away. The Lord is a sun and a shield to all that trust in him. May he always be your guide. Their families were not rich, but they were literate and spiritual. My great-grandmother Millicent did not attend college, but her sister graduated from Northeastern Ohio Normal School in 1908. Millicent, like her mother before her, was active in the Women's Christian Temperance Union of Mahoning County, Ohio. In 1874, the Temperance Crusade began in Ohio, and the first national convention of the Women's Christian Temperance Union was held in Cleveland. According to family lore, they sang in the prisons against the devil's liquor rum. We have no record of their involvement in women's suffrage, but the Temperance Union officially endorsed women's suffrage as a way of gaining more participation and influence for women. I don't think Millicent and her mother were of the Carrie Nation variety of temperance activists. To my knowledge, they confined their protest tactics to singing, not hatchets. Millicent was an activist, though, to the end. I remember listening to her interrogate my father at her 100th birthday party back in 1984 about sending AWACS, advanced surveillance planes, to Egypt. My father had been a no vote in Congress, and fortunately for him, my great-grandmother approved. She was tireless in her efforts to register people to vote, even working to register more than 100 fellow residents at her assisted living facility. As the descendant of abolitionists and temperance workers, I think she tried to register only Republicans. The women in my family were a force to be reckoned with because of their faith, energy, and intelligence, but also sheer longevity. Millicent's grandmother, Sarah Millicent Rose Howard, was born in 1836 and was still going strong at age 87 until she stepped out of a jitney and was struck by a car in 1923. My mother treasures a quilt knitted by Sarah, whom they called Ma Howard. My mother's mother, Carol Creed Wells, graduated from Ohio University in the early 1930s at a time when few women went to college, much less graduated. Kelley and I have a framed picture of her in the foyer of our home that never fails to draw the notice of guests. In the photo, she is sitting, knees bent, aiming a rifle at a distant target, a row of carbines in the background. Carol, or Graham as we knew her, was not quite the teetotaler her mother was. She loved parties, joined a sorority, and was a bit of a rule breaker. As kids, we loved the stories she told us of my grandfather climbing in the second-story window of her dormitory long after visiting hours for boys had ended. Graham was an avid coin collector and spent hours with me as a child, sorting coins and peering at mint marks. As time went on, her vision began to fail, and I became her eyes, spying the faintest of mint marks on weather-worn coins. I went with her to the eye surgeon as her cataracts were removed, then her corneas replaced, and finally when we received the sad news that macular degeneration had irreparably damaged her retinas. Those trips to the ophthalmologist with her were among the reasons I decided ultimately to become an eye surgeon. My father's mother, Margaret Dumont Paul, finished high school while her husband finished only 8 grades. My dad says that without her management and accounting skills, the family dairy business would never have thrived to become the main milk delivery system in Carnegie and Greentree, Pennsylvania. Even after long days working at the dairy and caring for 5 sons, Margaret found time to help those less fortunate than she. She delivered Meals on Wheels to invalids and shut-ins well into her 80s. Even after she was crippled with her own arthritis and maladies, she would carry meals up long winding stairs to houses perched in the hilly sections of South Pittsburgh. My grandmother lived in an era when every penny was counted and cataloged. Lights were never burned without a purpose. The tap water was not allowed to run continuously when washing dishes. And buying new clothes only occurred when the old ones were worn out. I interviewed my grandmother when she was 90 about her work in the dairy business and as a volunteer for the American Bible Society. She spoke of taking the trolley to downtown Pittsburgh to deliver Bibles to an African-American church. Although we sometimes assume race relations were far superior in the northern cities before the civil rights movement, the truth is that separation, de facto, existed in the north as well. Her trip to downtown Pittsburgh, especially alone, was considered daring at the time. She never told her husband of 70 years about delivering those Bibles. Grandmother Margaret lived in a time when, by all appearances, the men in the family made the decisions. But there was always a hint that the men could never have made the right decisions without her help. She was not boastful, but it was always clear that she was confident of her abilities. My mother, Carol Wells Paul, followed in her mother's footsteps to Ohio University. My father went to Gettysburg College, and my mother, just like her grandmother, Millicent, wrote...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.